there are at least three reasons why one should be concerned about what's happening in agriculture in terms of, you know, what kind of farming models are we adopting. For one thing, most land on this planet is under farming. If you go wrong there, it means that you're going, you know, very wrong in a magnitude of a huge scale. Two, in a country like India, most people live off agriculture. We're talking about millions of livelihoods being intricately and closely and directly connected with agriculture. If you go wrong there, once again, you're really talking about lots of lives and livelihoods directly impacted. And one third reason which should concern all of us is the fact that the very food that we eat to survive, to stay healthy, to stay alive, it comes from farming. If that food becomes toxic or goes wrong in other ways, let's say we have more and more non-nutritious food being produced in farming, it impacts each one of us as food consumers. Every human being is affected. Today, the ill effects of a particular model of farming that's been adopted 40, 45, 50 years ago, they're showing up. They're showing up quite starkly. Today we have a state in India which, in terms of its size, is very small. Just 1.5% of this country's agricultural land is held by this one small state. And the incidence of a lot of chronic health problems are being correlated to toxic agricultural technologies that were adopted by Punjab, called the breadbasket of India. But today it's being called the cancer capital of India. In its effort to supply food to the rest of the country, here were farmers who were pumping in more and more chemicals. And today you find that it's not only environmental health problems in this state, but water has depleted. The remaining water there in this state is all contaminated with poisons. Land is terribly degraded. Punjab's farmers are the most indebted farmers in this country. And after all the high levels of production that they achieved, they still have very little income to show for the kind of disaster that they have brought upon themselves. There's an express recognition today that things have gone wrong. But the problem is, the corrective measures are not being taken in any fundamental ways. So we've moved some way ahead in terms of people recognizing that we've got to think with forethought about our farming. But what is being done to address the real issues emerging is too small and in many cases too late. Incidentally, in India, you know, when the frustration levels become too unbearable and high, the way out that hundreds of thousands of farmers are opting for is to commit suicide. And here comes this notion in this development vision of displacing farmers, that we will continue with farming, but with a small set of farmers. And they would hold large land under each one of them, and they can feed the rest of us. But very clearly, in India in the past 15 years or so, we've seen that other sectors have grown very impressively economically, but they have no employment potential. They just cannot absorb people. And more importantly, the kind of skills that millions of people have in rural India, it's actually our strength that we make good use of them within farming. Seed is one of the most critical inputs in agriculture. Without seed, you can't do farming. And here is a country, India, where there were literally hundreds of thousands of varieties that were evolved by farmers. They were not given by nature as is. And farmers used to save seeds from their crops and resow them. But today, seed is not just one input. Seed is a whole baggage. If you bring in a particular kind of seed, you can be sure that it's been bred to respond to particular other sets of inputs that you have to provide. It includes agrochemicals mostly. And seed is also being created in ways that farmers cannot save the seed from their crop. It is being created through technologies like hybrid seeds, technologies like genetic modification. Here are people who, entities who want to make money out of farming. Profit is their bottom line. And they are using such technologies to make sure that farmers come back to them again and again, season after season, by saying that I have created this, I own this, I have invented this, and therefore nobody else has rights to use it without my permission and without paying up to me. This has enormous potential as far as corporations are concerned, this kind of a legal protection in the form of patents and so on. And, you know, just to give you an example, if Bill Gates can be the richest man in the world by selling copyrighted software, how many of us own computers? How often do we buy new software packages and pay up royalties? And you could still earn so much money on it. If you can bring that system of ownership over something like seed, claim that royalty over every dinner plate, every meal that every human being ever eats. Imagine what sort of monies could be made. The only way that you know, farm livelihoods in countries like India can survive is to somehow push back these corporate seed monopolies and ensure that seed and knowledge of seed is back in the hands of farmers. There's of course a lot of campaigning that's possible in terms of policy analysis, sometimes adopting legal strategies, you know, lobbying with your elected leaders and creating a debate, making sure that there's a wider debate through media picking up some of these issues and so on. But ultimately, the war will be won only if farmers, the last farmer in this country, actually holds on to seed because she or he realizes that this is something too critical and too sovereign, if you like, to be handed over to anyone else. If we can reach a stage by dialoguing with all farmers in this country and by creating grassroots level alternatives where seed is physically back in our farms, in the hands of women, in each farm household, and we're talking about hundreds of varieties of seeds and not just one or two seeds. If we can do that, then we would have effectively defied any other strategy that corporations like Monsanto can bring in. After all, you can't sue and jail millions of farmers. That's the only way, and that is Gandhi's way of, you know, if you like, civil disobedience. That's the way that American civil leaders have also adopted. That's what we need to have on the ground in the villages of India to bring back seed into everybody's hands.